A good director creates an environment which gives the actor the encouragement to fly. Lights, camera, and various actions thereupon. This is Modern Escape. Hello and welcome to the show. My name is Oodles, the director of this fine production. And joining me, as always, we have the gaffer. It's Candy.
Oh, hello.
You're surprised to be here.
The director of photography, it's Gadget.
Hello.
The stunt coordinator, it's Stig.
Hello.
And catering assistant, it's Biggie.
Hello. Cornish pasties are over there.
What about cake? All right, Cornish pasties. How are we all doing? Good?
Marvellous.
Yeah.
I don't care. We need to sell shit. Stig?
Okay. God, you're a pushy director. So, if you like what we do, we have a Patreon. If you head over to patreon.com/modernescapism, on there you'll find the three tiers we do. For £5 a month, the Modern Escapees will get you an extended edition of this episode every week, as well as at least one monthly special and any other specials we are doing. Currently, we are on our Moon Knight spoiler cast run, which will come out once a week until that show's finished. If you are into Dungeons & Dragons, for £5 a month, the Scorched Sheep tier is... Excellent. What? Fuck that. The Scorched Sheep tier will get you ad-free early access of our Dungeons & Dragons podcast, as well as original artwork, music, battle maps, character sheets, and anything put together for the show. And £7.50, the Biggie Bundle, that gets you everything. Subject to VAT.
And cut. Excellent. Well done.
I need to do another take, on. Director.
No.
Okay.
One and done. We're running out of reel.
Shit.
One and done. Let's get on with the next. I want to know what the busiest man in the South has been up to this week. Biggie.
Oh, fucking hell. Straight into me. Okay. Yeah, not a lot, I'm afraid. Literally, this is going to be so quick. I watched Death on the Nile with the wife. Yeah, it's not as good as the last one, really. I quite agree with what Stiggy and I think Eulers, you commented on it last time as well, didn't you? It's actually a bit more, quite boring, to be honest.
I liked it.
It's
all loaded into the back at the end of the film. It's weird.
Yeah.
Just side note, really odd. On it, who the fuck invites all those people on a honeymoon with them?
Yeah, that's true. So it's just two people,
isn't it?
Yeah.
And I love how Poirot has always been the same place as his mate. You know, like they're in fucking Egypt, and he's on the pyramid, and this is like, oh, Poirot! It's like, what are the odds? You know,
he's a world-faring man.
I've seen a couple of screenshots, especially from that bit at the pyramids at the beginning, where the green screening on it looks dreadful.
Oh, it is bad. It is really bad.
Really,
it reminds me of those really early, completely CGI movies with actors in. You know, like that one, the Skyrocket or something, or whatever it was called. The Neo War one.
Captain in the World Tomorrow or something.
That's the one.
Yeah.
It really stands out like that. It's just really poor. So I don't know why they bothered, to be perfectly honest. They should have just filmed somewhere on location, make it a little bit more naturalistic. But there you go. The only other thing
during the pandemic, though, so they couldn't really.
That's a fair point. all right. But because a friend of mine was talking about doing some retro gaming stuff through one of our group chats, he got me thinking about getting involved in my Raspberry Pi. And I used it for my Vita docking system, which I obviously don't use at the moment. So I thought I'll change that, and ended up just going on a little, very quick journey down the route of retro gaming, and found a really cool website called Arcade Punks, which is a hell of a lot more useful than one of the other punks that we know, and it's not Daft Punk.
He's a Daft Punk.
He is. I just downloaded an image from there, whacked it onto my Raspberry Pi, and I have all the retro gaming needs that I need.
obviously, all these games you own physically,
absolutely,
don't
yes.
I thought as much.
And thanks to Last Ginger for pointing that
the
out.
Last
to me,
Ginger,
so yeah, really,
I don't think he is.
But yeah, I managed to download that, get that all up and running. It didn't take very long at all.
I think they're brilliant, them little Raspberry Pis. I think they're fantastic.
They're brilliant. They're so good. And there's some there. I'm only using like a 32 gig SD card.
Yeah, getting 16-bit like stuff on it.
3 terabytes. There's files there. It's just, can you imagine what that must hold? Just every gaming system ever. And all the ROMs and all the stuff on there, and it's really cool. But yeah, really cool website. Do check it out if you're interested in that. You can get everything you need there.
If you own it physically, let me just say again.
And yes, because I do own lots of games. But yeah, that is literally it for me. I've been so busy with work and my daughter's birthday.
That's fine, mate. You've been a busy guy. You're a good person, and we love you all for it. Gadget, what you been up to?
I have been continuing with Elden Ring. I'm so close to the end. So close, I can taste it. I'm at the point now where I don't care about any kind of spoilers. I've seen enough of the ending bosses to know what's going on.
Have you managed to see him? Did you just, like, when you were looking for advice and stuff, you just stumbled on him by accident? It's shit when he does that.
It's sort of, but when you get to that kind of point, like, I'm not really that bothered. Like, there's one boss that was a little bit of a surprise to me. Because obviously, as you're going along, you pay attention to the character names and stuff like that. You know, I haven't fought this person yet. I'll probably fight him soon. You know, that
character. Yeah, it's so obvious, isn't it?
Yeah. There's one that was a surprise to me, which I'll admit, I think is a pretty cool idea. But it's basically the game has now reached the point where it's funneling you down what feels like a boss corridor.
It's turned into Dark Souls 3, hasn't it?
Yeah, the last dungeon, the fuck me, I hated it so much.
Crap. It's proper crap.
It just did not need to be there. Like, you could have like had like the bit that gets you to the last dungeon be the start of the boss run. That would have been great. Didn't need it. Yes. Anyway, I'm still loving it. I reckon I've maybe got about 2 or 3 hours left in it, depending on how difficult these fights are going to be. So, hopefully next week I should have finished it. But aside from that, I have been watching the new series of Space Force.
Space Force, what's that?
So Space Force is it's a Netflix sitcom created by Greg Daniels, who created The Office.
Now you're talking my language.
And starring Steve Carell.
Whoa!
Oh, I know what you mean.
And okay. The first season of it came out in 2020.
That's right, yeah.
Because I don't know if you all remember, but Donald Trump created Space Force in real life, as in a militarized branch of NASA.
He did. Yeah. The aliens.
Star Wars, for real.
Yeah. So this TV show is kind of lampooning that idea. And like in the first series, like, they never mentioned Trump outright. They just referred to him as POTUS. But, you know, they have to deal with his ridiculous and silly proclamations and have to deal with, like, getting back to the moon for some inexplicable reason that they don't actually need to do it. But it's got a really stellar cast to it. So you've got Steve Carell as General Mark Ned, the 4-star general who's leading Space Force. John Malkovich as the head scientist, Dr. Mallory. Ben Schwartz as F. Tony Scatapaducci, often referred to as Fuck Tony, because he is the social media director and he's an incredibly annoying man.
Mm-hmm.
Diana Silvers plays Mark's daughter, Erin. Jimmy O. Yang is another one of the scientists, Dr. Chan. And you get like kind of walk-on parts by like Patrick Warburton, Daedric Bader, Jane Lynch, Roy Wood Jr., people, stuff like that. That Patrick Warburton. Expertly mustachioed and playing a military general.
I love it, mate.
Yeah. And you know, the first season was a very kind of, it was a very much a political satire. You know, it was taking the piss out of American politics at the time. And it was very funny. The second season's changed slightly because now that it's the new administration,
it's not funny anymore. It's boring.
No. It still is funny, but they've done what they did with The Office, where the first season had a very distinct style of humor, which it didn't necessarily suit. This one's become more of a direct workplace comedy.
Oh, I just meant the administration.
Well, yeah, the administration. But it's a little bit more surreal. The characters are a little bit more well thought out. a little bit stranger, weird things goes on. At one point, one of the episodes, they lose communications with the satellites, and when they finally get communication back with it, a Windows update starts in the command center, and they still can't communicate with anything.
I always wondered if anything like that ever happens.
You get John Malkovich just stomping around the command center going, "Fuck Microsoft!" at the top of his voice.
We've all said it.
We have many times. It's got a lot of heart to it. There's a lot of really sweet scenes in it. It has got a lot of the more gentle humor from The Office. It doesn't have a lot of the cringe humor. It's not like outwardly cringy. It is more like a traditional sitcom. Yeah. But I really rate it. And the first season kind of got a bit slated in the American press. I think it had like a 38% Rotten Tomatoes score.
Because they're taking piss out of America. They don't like that.
The second season's got a 90% score. It's as if they've like found their feet with the second season. It's not quite
That's
as long.
What Daniels seems to do though, doesn't he?
Greg Daniels always does. Same with Parks and Recreation. First season,
yeah, decent
fucking terrible.
First season. Well, yeah, I suppose it is. And then he just gets into his own stride, doesn't he?
He does, yeah. Wow. And even Steve Carell, he writes a couple of the episodes for the season. He plays Mark Naird really well. There is a lot of Michael Scott to him, but he's a more respectable person.
I've got to watch now.
Yeah, he's not as awkward as Michael Scott, but you can say he's got like the nicer bits of Michael Scott's character. You know, when Michael Scott's like genuinely nice to somebody, he's got a lot of that to him. So I really rate it. I think it's a really good show. There's two seasons of it. They're both on Netflix, like 17 episodes in total. You'll smash through them in an evening. It's really, really good and well worth watching.
I'm gonna, mate. I'm absolutely gonna. I'm excited.
Did you say that
now was
the fourth season?
No, it's two seasons, 17 episodes.
I was going to say, how's there four seasons?
Carol Vorderman in the corner there going, huh?
Yeah, literally.
But they have set the ending of season two up for a third season. So, and the third season looks like it's getting a bit Armageddon, so that'll be fun.
Oh, wow.
Nice.
Tempted to see if they'll break Michael Bay out the cupboard for that one.
Oh. Let him out, let him out.
But yeah, absolutely rate it. Well, absolutely well worth watching.
Cool. Is that your week, pal?
Yeah, that's my week because at least it's mostly been Elden Ring or Dune Messiah, which I'm struggling with Dune Messiah. I've read it before and I don't know why I'm struggling with through it this time.
It's because you know what's going to happen.
I do not like it.
Yeah,
I like Messiah, but...
Well, I'm like two-thirds of the way through and I'm just like, oh, come on, just fucking finish. You know? So getting through
Messiah,
a solid ending.
I've got a bit of a god complex myself, so it's you know what I mean. It's fun
read. I guess the issue I'm having with it, even like I remember reading it really quickly the first time I read it as a teenager, and I'm reading it again now and just think, God, nothing fucking happens in this book. They just stood around talking.
It never does.
And all this fucking is it hate or is it Duncan Idaho bullshit just does my fucking head in.
Yeah. Oh God, these are really niche. Ramblings as well, because a lot of people didn't even get as far as Messiah.
I know, yeah. Oh, yeah, you have to be really committed to understand this particular rambling.
Yes. Excellent. Thank you very much. Let's move on to Stick.
Unfortunately, I've done a bit of a biggie this week. Been too busy.
Well, you've been playing with Wallpaper Engine.
God, no, that's sad.
It's so good.
It's not.
I caught him playing with it.
You can see my animated desktops and phone. It looks so good.
I do have it.
You can just make your own. I've got fucking Photoshop.
They're all there. You don't need to make your own. They're all there, already done. Music, animations. I even showed Gadget one originally in it and a Blade Runner background. It was so cool. Animated.
These
rain,
are all simple things that you can do yourself, though.
I don't need to because it's already done.
Stop stepping on six cows.
I do actually have it. I've just never delved into it for some reason.
Check it out, trust me.
I will.
We'll come back and apologize.
Oh, God. I will. I'm sure I will.
I've still got the default wallpaper on my bloody desktop that when I open the laptop up.
So what I did do this week though is one of the things I did do is I watched The Boot Room Boys, which was a BT Sports documentary. It played after the Liverpool Benfica Champions League game on Tuesday, and it's basically the story of how Bill Shankly took Liverpool, a struggling Liverpool side who'd been stuck in the second division for 6 years, and basically made them into an absolute juggernaut. So it just kind of tells a story of like I said, what Bill Shankly did, how he changed the ethos of the club, and how he instilled those values. So when he stepped down and passed it on to, how he passed it on to Bob Paisley and then Joe Fagan and so on and so on. Eventually now we got to Jurgen Klopp and how those kind of values of the club have kind of moved their way down into the club and how it, and basically how story about how Liverpool became a successful club. So that was really good. Not more to really say on that. It's, it kind of, if you're a Liverpool fan, you kind of know most of those, that stories anyway.
A few of my mates said it's a really nice documentary.
Yeah, it is. It's got like talking heads from the likes of Phil Thompson, Dalgleish, Roy Evans, cool. David Fairclough, Alan Kennedy, that kind of, Ian Rush.
I'll watch any football documentary from any team. I just really like football documentaries. I think they're good.
Yeah, if you're into like your football documentaries or your autobiographies and you're not just about, oh, I only want to watch or read stuff about my own team, then it's definitely worth checking out. Because like I say, if you're not a Liverpool fan, there might be some things in there that you've never heard about before.
Yeah, exactly. So, it's more exciting if you don't know the club.
Yeah, so that was on BT Sports. If you've got, say, if you've got a Sky or BT subscription, you'll probably be able to get that on demand from them.
Gadget, you're going to watch that?
No. Almost fell asleep at the description of it. I'm sure it's a wonderful documentary if you like football, but fuck no.
On to something Biggie's going to fall asleep with.
Wrestling.
The other thing I did this week was wrestling. It was Wrestlemania weekend.
It was.
Wrestlemania 38 took part over two nights at the AT&T Stadium in Dallas, which is the place I went to when I went to Wrestlemania. It is a very impressive stadium. Like, absolutely huge.
Huge, isn't it?
It's got the biggest, like, screen in the world in an indoor stadium. It's absolutely massive in the center above the where the ring or the football field would be. It's honestly absolutely huge. Yeah, they did this over Saturday and Sunday. They obviously had the Hall of Fame the night before as well, with The Undertaker. Like, after he's retired, he officially did the Hall of Fame, and he's kind of, that's him now, over and done with. And yeah, for a show which I had zero interest in, I always just kind of watch WrestleMania because it's WrestleMania. Like,
it's a tradition, isn't it? Even I watch it.
Yeah, like, their weekly shows are pretty shit. Like, even the Raw after WrestleMania is usually like one of the best Raws of the year because they go all out with surprises and stuff. And even that just felt meh. But yeah, I was actually really surprised at how much I enjoyed it. A couple of duff matches. You probably could have taken a few matches out and made it one night. But obviously two nights now, they've kind of realized, oh, we can get double the amount of money.
Yeah.
So why not?
Because people just pay for two tickets, don't they, and get hotels.
Yeah, well, yeah, all the packages. Like, it's whatever it is. But yeah, if you're going to sell two nights as well, you've got one night where you can sell it on some one thing, and the other night you can sell it on the other if you're only going to.
It makes sense financially.
One night. Yeah, so like the first one had The Miz and Logan Paul facing Rey Mysterio and his son Dominic Mysterio. And I've got to say, Logan Paul was outstanding.
I don't encourage the man.
No, I thought it was good as well.
He was really, really good.
He was good.
He's
flair for it, hasn't he?
Isn't he? So he obviously played the bad guy. He rolled down and he's walking down the aisle. His get up looked great. He was wearing a $3 million Pokemon card around his neck.
Yep.
Just
Charizard.
So much how much of a prick he is.
Remember when he got that fake one, though?
Yeah, but no, this one's a real one.
Yeah,
he did Easy Heat as well. So if you want to get the crowd to boo you, you do Eddie Guerrero's moves, you do his frog splash, you do his little shimmy and everything. And he did that, but he nailed it perfectly. As much of an arsehole as he is, he took to this like a duck to water.
Thing is, like, it's like boxing, wrestling. Do you know what I mean? Maybe he's
athletic, isn't he?
He's just a natural athlete.
A lot of effort into what he does. He's just a bell end.
Because he's a baddie, but he's an athletic baddie.
Yeah, I know this won't mean anything to anyone other than anyone who listens and likes wrestling. I know we do have a few listeners like that, but Cody Rhodes returned to the WWE after 6 years away, after he set up AEW. He couldn't come to an agreement with his contract there, so he left, did a massive return at WrestleMania, and they allowed him to keep his gimmick from the other company, which is absolutely...
It's wild, that, though, isn't it?
Yeah, that's massive when it comes to Vince McMahon and WWE, to allow someone to keep their... what made them better and more well-known outside of the company. And that was huge. And then we had Stone Cold Steve Austin, had one last match 19 years later.
He wasn't very good, though, was he?
No, he's very slow.
He's very slow, and he was missing. Yeah. He was dropping a lot and missing a lot, but it's nice to see it.
Yeah, it was good. It was still, I still really enjoyed it. It basically, they did a no holds barred match, which means we can get through the limitations of what you can do by just having him hit the other person with weapons and throw them around, and
don't have to suplex anybody.
But yeah, the crowd loved it. I really enjoyed it. It was really good. But the biggest surprise and the most fun I had on the second night, Johnny Knoxville against Sami Zayn in Anything so Goes good. Match. And imagine Jackass, but in a WWE ring. And that's what you got.
Okay, I might go and look that one up. That sounds
no, it was a really good gadget.
I would really recommend just watching that just because it's so funny. The stuff they pulled out, you say you're going to watch it, but I need to talk about it, really, so I will spoil some of the moments. It involved things like a table full of mouse traps laid on top of it. It had tasers, it had pyro going off, had Wee Man coming out from under the ring and beating Sami Zayn up and then body slamming him.
How long do you think he was there
body
for?
Slamming him. Wee Man, I don't know.
All night?
No. There's the ways of getting him in and out somehow. Like, when the crowd aren't watching and the lights go down and things like that, they have
scurrying
there. I always wondered that, whether there was like a trap door under there or something. But yeah, bowling ball to the nuts. And the best moment is, do you remember the hand from Jackass 3, I think?
Yeah,
the
big
high
one.
Five hand.
Oh, my favorite stunt they ever did.
They never, you couldn't see it throughout the whole match. Never knew it was there. You would have known it was there if you were in the crowd. If you're watching from home, you do not know it's there. At one moment, Sami Zayn just turns around and whack! That hand comes out of nowhere and just whacks him. I was absolutely in hysterics watching this. It was the best thing of both nights. You have some people online like taking me, this isn't wrestling, this isn't that. I enjoyed it. I absolutely loved that match. It was so funny. And Sami Zayn is like, if you know the character, it's the perfect person to do that stunt with, like that match. So yeah, that was really good. The rest of it was standard affair. It was all right, but yeah, overall really surprising. It's probably the best WrestleMania in the last several years, this is WrestleMania 38. Yep. Other than the odd match here and there, it's probably the best one since WrestleMania 30.
So, yeah, which is a big famous one.
Yeah, which some
lovely person
has
put that whole fight up onto YouTube.
Yes.
Yeah, it's all that.
I would recommend watching it. It's 15 minutes long, but it's really good fun. It's just Jackass in a wrestling ring.
Yeah.
So, yeah, WrestleMania is really the main thing I did this week.
Excellent, mate. Brilliant, brilliant, brilliant. Caddy!
I also did a biggie, but I'll try and stretch it out.
I love how it's become a biggie doing this.
That's what I did with the wrestling, then I'll try and stretch it out. Talking about a lot of matches and people, you're all just like, what?
Huh? I just need to make the listeners aware. He's been working all week. He's not just on the dole.
I mean, he says he's been working all week.
Yeah, that's true. He's
he's been working making wallpaper engines.
That's his new business.
Yeah.
Turning NFTs into wallpapers.
Oh, God. Not getting into NFTs.
Have I just made a multi-million dollar idea?
Yeah, let's cut that bit out so no one steals it.
Cut it out.
But I do want to say, so listening back last week, I think I was probably a little bit too tough on Tiny Tina. I think probably moaning about the broken multiplayer.
She's emailed you, hasn't she?
Tiny Tina, at tinytina.com. I think it sort of overshadowed sort of my intent to express that just actually how much fun it is when it does work, or when you're playing solo. I think it's stabilized a little bit with multiplayer, but there's still problems. Most of the time we just can't chat to each other. But the loot drops just tick all my serotonin boxes as well. When you get all that loot, it makes me feel all tingly.
Is it still the same color scheme that we know and love?
Oh yeah, if you play Borderlands, you know what you're in for.
Yeah.
I finished Bel Air and Severance. Both of those series finished this last week.
A lot of people saying Severance is one of the best shows of the last 5 years.
I would probably agree. I can't remember a show that I've wanted to binge quite that much, and it does end on a cliffhanger. I think it has been renewed for another season, so we will get some answers. But yeah, both of them finished quite strong. Bel Air as well, it stayed strong sort of throughout the season. Once you're used to what sort of a show it is, I think it's easier to enjoy it. Just it's hard, but try not to make comparisons to the original Fresh Prince, because it's not a comedy. It's a sort of TV drama.
Yeah, clips of like just with a lot of swearing and you know, them using the N-word and things like that.
Oh, yeah.
Like, oh, wow. Like, this is not, you know, they've not like toned it down at all. Like,
no, it's definitely R-rated. In fact, it gives it does the little warning before it shows, saying it obviously there's violence and swearing. And
I saw a Twitter like review of it saying, calling it William Shakespeare's The Fresh Prince of Bel Air. Like how it's like a dark tragedy. But, I was like, what?
Feels like it would be overselling it, no matter how good it is.
Yeah, that's not quite the comparison I'd make, but I sort of understand where it's coming from.
I've not
from,
even seen a trailer of it or anything.
It's pretty good once you know sort of what you're doing with it. It's worth a watch if you can. I also started We Crashed. I got about 2/3 of the first episode in, and I got letoed out of it.
You say it happens to the best of us.
I just can't. which is a shame, because as Gadget said, it's a really interesting story, and I do want to know sort of what exactly went down. But I can read about it without being letoed.
I'll send you some podcasts that don't involve Jared Leto.
Oh, perfect.
He seems to be Hollywood's little golden secret at the moment, doesn't he, Leto? And I don't get what he's done, what he's got on all these people to get into all these big roles.
Something
the
isn't
fuck
it?
Has he got on everyone?
Yes, watch this space. But the main thing I did, I watched a good old Netflix documentary called Trust No One, The Hunt for the Crypto King.
That's a title, isn't it?
Oh, it's a mouthful. Yeah, I thought it was just, anyway, get past the title, it's fine. So it basically is the story of Jerry Cotton, who's a so-called a crypto genius, and he founded the cryptocurrency trading platform called Quadriga. And the way we're sort of introduced to the situation of what's going on, it's the story of a crypto investor, a Canadian Chinese man called Tong Zhu, and he'd taken out about 85 grand's worth of loans and managed to invest in Bitcoin whilst it was still only a few dollars. And sure enough, very quickly, Bitcoin exploded, and at its highest point, I think it was worth about 18 grand in dollars. So this guy was just absolutely living the high life, multiple mortgages, luxury cars, boats, the whole lot, just absolutely living it up. And so in 2021, so this was obviously filmed quite recently, because it all happened within the last 6 months, I would think. So, in 2021, you'll probably remember, China announced that it was banning everything sort of crypto related, and Bitcoin absolutely crashed. So overnight, its value went from 18 grand or whatever it was at that point down to about 4,000. So
3 grand or something like that, wasn't it?
I think so. So it's 4 grand in dollars. So I suppose it would depend on the day, but yeah, there or there. But anyway, it absolutely crashed. So
it turned billionaires into millionaires.
Yeah, the poor souls.
Poor bastards.
F. Take a moment's silence. But anyway, this guy, he went from having millions, as he said, to about 400 grand overnight, which, you know, 400 grand in a bank account, fine, but it's not the millions that he was used to. Yeah, I've never had that much. I mentioned that the Tong was Canadian. So when he decided, so what he had to do basically was withdraw the remaining currency to his bank account or to cash. And, rather than withdraw it from the trading platform that he was on, which would withdraw it as American dollars, of the bank, the bank would have taken about a 2% commission to transfer it to Canadian dollars. What he decided to do was to transfer his Bitcoin to this Quadriga sort of platform, which was a Canadian company as well. and withdraw it that way. So he started the withdrawal process, and after a few days, he'd heard nothing, no money, nothing.
God, imagine. All.
Bear in mind, this is his life savings, and this is literally all he's had left from what remained of what he'd invested. And he's, you know, got the 85 grand to pay back. He's got mortgages, this, that, and the other. So several weeks later, he'd heard nothing still. And this post appears on the Quadriga website from Jerry Cotton's wife, saying that he died suddenly and unexpectedly whilst he was in India on their honeymoon, I think, due to complications of Crohn's disease. But not only that, he died with all the passwords to everything. So everything to do with that company had died of with him. No one had access to anything. So supposedly no one could release these funds that people had asked for. So inevitably, the internet sleuths got involved. So they got on the case because obviously the circumstances were sus. So people's first thoughts obviously were that he'd faked his own death, and there appeared to be substantial evidence to back it up. Someone got hold of some information that made it seem as though a load of money had been transferred from Quadriga to a plastic surgeon in Bermuda. So people were like, you know, has he gone through loads of facial surgery so that he can't be recognized and just kind of go on with everyone's money, living the high life? He also filed a will about 12 days before he died. And then obviously the most obvious thing is that he was 30 years old. 30-year-olds don't tend to just drop down dead, even if they do suffer from Crohn's disease. If I go on,
life-threatening disease.
But I mean, it's not very pleasant, but you can live with it, and many people do.
Yes.
But anyway, if I go any kind of further with it, I'll end up spoiling it for the people that do want to watch it. But as always, there's kind of a 100 twists and turns, as there normally is with a Netflix documentary.
But yeah, cliffhangers, even though you're going to binge it all. I never got.
Well,
that.
Actually, this one is just the one episode, so it's like a sort of a feature-length movie rather than a actual series. But yeah, it was fun. It filled up the afternoon, and it was interesting to see what had actually transpired. But that was it for me this week. Another little short one.
Fair enough. Right. Last but not least, me. Well, probably least. I watched Jimmy Savile, A British Horror Story on Netflix. I've not finished it yet. It's a two-parter, 3 hours basically. It's a two-parter. We all know the story. I'm not going to get into it. We all know the story. I'm not using this as my main topic because, as I said in the Discord, I don't want to put him on as cover art. But yeah, it's a really slick documentary. I have a little bit of an issue with it. The first episode that I've watched is proper glorifying him.
Mm.
Like, it's weird how the whole nation at that time, and I'm blaming my parents, your parents, our parents, because it was their generation that accepted this behavior. That man was telling everyone how bad he was from the get-go. I know it sounds ridiculous, but he wasn't hiding very much at all. All these scenes, he was such a grabby bastard. And it's awful, but it's a really slick documentary. As it is a Netflix one as well. Really, really good archival footage, how he used to cozy up to the royal family. And I didn't know this, but he was the royal family's advisor for a very long time. Can you imagine?
On what?
Just on public affairs. Can you imagine that? Like Jimmy Savile's there going, Prince Charles, Prince Andrew, I recommend you do these charities for these people. Children's hospitals, now then. You know what I mean?
Please don't do the impression. I'm going to cut you out if you keep doing that.
But you were doing that, and it's like, what the fuck? Why were they listening to this man? And there's like loads of like secret like letters that have been uncovered where they're all like, yeah, we know about your transgressions, but you've raised so much money for charity.
But that was the trouble, wasn't it?
It is really, it really is a horror to watch. Absolutely disgusting, but it's a really slick documentary.
When I was on there, but I think he went on Canberra, my very first cruise ship. I think he did.
I met him when I was 3 years old. I've mentioned that before, but
imagine him being let loose on a cruise ship for 2 weeks at sea.
He'd have got an helicopter out.
I wonder if Netflix do these documentaries. They always seem to coincide with some kind of other TV show coming out about the subject.
It does, doesn't it?
The Reckoning is a Jimmy Savile four-part series with Steve Coogan coming out later this year.
Yeah, I still can't believe he took that on.
Yeah, it seemed BBC. It's interesting bit, move,
anyway,
wasn't it?
We'll get into that. yeah, I've noticed this before, just like when there's been a film out or something. I'm pretty sure when Spencer came out, there was a Princess Diana documentary dropped.
The Diana musical.
Yeah, let's not forget that.
That as well.
Last week,
but
forget.
Yeah, that is the documentary. That quite a lot, don't they? I think they just... I often wonder whether they're that asked about the actual subject and more bothered about, oh, this is going to be the talk of the moment because something else
is coming
out.
What they're doing.
Yeah.
It's just stupid.
Yeah. It's like, what's that film production company that, like, you know, some big science fiction blockbuster comes out and they'll do, like, a
Asylum.
Really schlocky version
of
Asylum. Yeah. Mm. Same principle.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, like I say, it's a tough watch, but it's really slickly produced and it's got some good talking heads and stuff. And what they do in this documentary is make people that met him in the past and they got it on camera watch that footage again and watching them cringe. I'm like, you let him get away with this. Your fuckers are out. A lot of you guys are to blame. And it's harrowing, but it's an 18 as well. So it's not a nice thing to talk about on a podcast, but I'm going to anyway. The main thing I've done this week, and it's already been discussed, is I finished Horizon Forbidden West.
That was quick.
It's oodles, man. Like, this guy says, I haven't got a gaming backlog. That's because you've completed Elden Ring and Horizon Forbidden West in just over a month.
What's wrong with that?
It's a week for each of them. You only started playing Horizon on Monday.
Nothing wrong with that. 27 hours. Boom. Done. I did have a week off, so...
Go out. Yeah, that's true. I'll give you that.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, Elden Ring took me 2 weeks. So.
Go outside. Smell some flowers.
I've got a fever. I've got a lot to say about Horizon Forbidden West, but a lot of it's what Candy's already said. The best way to say what I thought of the whole game is I binge-watched a lot of X-Files while playing this. So, as you can imagine, the story wasn't really grabbing me. Like Candy said, it's a bit dull, isn't it?
Yeah. Especially like that whole, like I said, the kind of mid-game slump.
Yeah, I think it gets better near the end. I like stop watching X-Files and then near the end I'm like, oh, I'm into this. And then it does obviously the, guess what, there's going to be a sequel. Mm. I kind of want to, like I had thoughts going into it. I was watching, minor spoilers if you want, but it's not exactly bang on. These were just my predictions while I was playing it. I was watching X-Files about aliens and stuff like that. And then this plot in Horizon Forbidden West started going towards aliens. I'm like, what? What's happening here? And I won't tell any more about that because it's probably the most interesting aspect of the game. And it's really difficult to explain, really, without spoiling it. But I think Final Fantasy VII.
Yeah, because the story is surprising in a really boring way.
Yeah,
like the idea is good, but the execution is shite.
So yeah, perfect. That's it. Like the gameplay is fantastic. It's like Monster Hunter Lite. It's like Monster Hunter Arcade. Like it's not methodical. It's easy. I never once struggled. I had it on the normal setting all the way through. I never felt like I was down on resource or anything like that. And like you do side quests, but all you get is like different coloured clothes. Yeah. There's only like four different outfits in the game, and you know I like dressing my dolls up. So that wasn't, there was no real, I did the Mass Effect style friendship quest, you know, to get full friendship with everybody. Because there's quite a bit of Mass Effect in this as well, isn't there, Candy?
Yeah, so
like you have a home base and stuff, and you come back and chat to each other and stuff. No shame.
Yeah, the home base was actually quite cool. I thought that was different from the original. Yeah. Because you didn't really have that kind of thing.
It was like the Big Brother house, wasn't it?
Yeah. Although that said, I didn't do a lot of the side quests. I had intended to finish it and come back and do them. I just couldn't be asked. There wasn't anything that was making me want to find out what happened with these people or make friends with other
tribes. I did every side quest in the game that wasn't collect 100 of these.
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean? I did all the main like story beat side quests were. But it is quite fascinating how they got every single NPC in this game to be voiced and fully animated. They all look incredible.
Like, the voice acting was a highlight.
Oh, yeah.
Really good.
It's just dull what they're saying.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, really strong. And I wanted to love it as well. And
yeah,
I just couldn't.
I like the scenery is incredible when you go in the jungles. Like in this full game, there's mountains, there's jungles, there's deserts, there's cityscapes. It's so varied and massive, but I don't know. It doesn't feel as cluttered as the first game. It seems a bit more condensed and tightly packed. The world's slightly bigger, but the monsters are bigger, so they need more room. But yeah, it's fun to play, but not really fun to. Like I saw on YouTube, like I think it was 20-hour movie of the game. Like, who the fuck wants to sit and watch that shit? Because that's boring. That's the worst part of it. The gameplay's fantastic, but I give it a 7 out of 10. But
I don't know if it's a bit of burnout on sort of massive open world RPGs type thing, because
no, that's my bread and butter, that, mate.
Yeah, and I exactly, that's, it's normally the kind of thing I love, but I think maybe we're so spoiled in that there's so many really, really good open world RPGs. If anything's only slightly below par, you just end up just hating it. Because I struggle to find I can't really put my finger on what it was exactly that it just didn't click with me.
It's hollow,
charisma.
Isn't it?
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, it's like a Christmas perfect way to say it. It's like Aloy's the main character, and she's not grown since the first game at all. She doesn't grow by the end. She's exactly the same. Just take a second, Aloy. For fuck's sake, listen to people. You know what I mean? She's just so brash and goes out there and starts firing arrows. I don't know. There's something endearing about her as a main character, but there was one character in it that I liked most. It was that dull. I can't remember his name. Do you know what I mean? The guy with one arm.
Yeah, I thought you really, were going to say him.
I really liked him.
The one arm bandit.
I was like, one arm bandit. Why can't I play as him? Do you know what I mean? He's fun. But yeah, it's all right. And again, Silen's the main baddie again. He's not my favorite main baddie. And there's lots of like alliance twists and turns and stuff, but yeah, it's all right. It's a 7 out of 10 game.
What I will say was good. The overarching story, this time was much more prominent. Whereas last time it was a lot of tribes at war. There's less of that and more of the overall what's going on kind of thing, which I did.
Because the whole world knows about everything now, doesn't it? That's the difference. They all know about these Bluetooth headsets that they keep wearing, the focusers. And do you know what I mean? They all know about all this, but yeah, it's absolutely fine. But then again, that was coming off the back of Elden Ring, which is one of the best games ever made. Buy it when it's cheap. That's my
I'll probably wait till I can get a cheap secondhand copy of it.
If you like the gameplay of the first one, you'll like playing this. You will. It's easy Monster Hunter. That's what
I enjoyed a lot of the first game. I never got around to finishing it because it felt bloated. I got about two thirds of the way through and went, oh, not more.
This game is shorter than the first game, but nearly half the length.
Most of the complaints I've seen about it online has mostly been around like the story and the story presentation. I try and think back when, well, why is anybody surprised? Because the story presentation in Killzone wasn't great either. Like the gameplay in Killzone was fine. You know, it was a really good shooter. But did anybody
really
remember
anything
in the story?
Do a narrative?
I think they just don't.
I don't think they do. They don't, do they? They don't.
I think, or
Killzone
I think the narrative
2 went for the whole dark dystopia, faction Helgas, Ray Winston being in charge at one point, or whatever the characters. I mean, I don't remember an awful lot about it, but they were just trying to make it like this, you know, Nazi type army.
That's
what they do in
the
first game.
But when you just said, I don't remember anything about it, there's the problem.
Yeah, that's what I mean. It's like,
like Gadget says, the gameplay was fine.
Gameplay was fine.
The single player was interesting enough.
They don't have a good track record of doing engaging narratives, is what I'm saying. Because even though the narrative of the first game isn't that engaging.
No. There's a few surprises, but it's not huge, is it?
No.
There's no gob open moments. For me, there's two different types of open world games you can create. You can create your Breath of the Wilds where you're creating your own story to it. There's barely any narrative in Breath of the Wild, is there?
Yeah.
And then there's these big open world ones with dialogue choices and stuff like that. some just, I don't know what it is. I think the balance is off on Horizon as a series. And I still think Aloy has got a place as a great character out there. I just think she needs that one game to
she's a better
elevate
writer.
Her up. She needs a better writer, yeah.
Yeah, if they went back to it, like you said last week, if they went back to Killzone and did it now, maybe, like as a shooter, but had a writer to create that backstory, to create a universe or whatever it is that you makes yeah. you interested in actually doing the main player. Because, yeah, Killzone 2, the multiplayer was fantastic, but the single player, it was all right. It was nothing special. But yeah,
it's mad, though, because, like, Guerrilla, their world building, their engine is absolutely...
Oh, Decima's incredible.
Yeah.
It's incredible. It's the most... apart from Children, they can't do Children, apart from BB in Death Stranding. Children.
No, they didn't
that
do that,
engine.
Though. That was Kojima Productions, though. They just built the engine.
Ah, right. That's true. Yeah. The children in this are horrendous. I can't look at them. They're awful. There's very little in this game, but I went to a village once and I had my headset on that allows like 3D audio.
Yeah.
And my Razer headset on. And hey, turn around. And I turn around, this little fucking creature there. I'm like, oh, God. Get my bow out. He's shooting. But yeah, the children in this are awful. Like by the end, I'm like, yeah, let's just wipe out the world, man. Get rid of these creatures. They're awful. But yeah, it's an art, like I say, 7 out of 10. Again, buy it when it's cheap. Let's move on to something far more interesting. It's a gadget episode. Take it away.
Yes, it is. It's a gadget episode, and we are pitching films to each other. So much like we did with the Dragon's Den episode last year, one of us has to tell the other four their film pitch, and we have to decide if it's going to get made or not.
Was that last year?
That was last year. That was last February.
Fuck.
Jesus.
I know. Very long time ago. So, who wants to go first? Because I know we normally do our own ones first, but I kind of want to let it sit in. I've got a shaken head from Biggie. Oodles has dropped his head out of the contention. Stig's cracking his knuckles. Mr. Confident there.
Stig's ready.
Stig it up, baby.
Not sure you guys want to go after me.
Oh, wow. Here we go. The expendable store.
So in the true form,
not far off.
Called it.
The true historic form of pitch meetings. So you got a movie for me?
I do, but this is going to be a little bit different.
Oh.
I'm ready for that. I like artistic Stig.
He spent all week actually filming it. We're about to have a presentation of the movie.
It's got his family involved, hasn't it?
Right, I just need to put things in the right place. I can read.
What on earth is he doing?
He's got a screenplay. He's got
a full PowerPoint.
Yeah.
Storyboarding.
I mean, I've got savings, mate, that I could invest if need be.
You can't make a film for 30 pence in a curly whirly.
Yeah, you can.
Magnum anus, did you say?
Yes, he comes as Magnum anus.
He's Magnum anus.
That's the title of the show, surely.
It has to be at this point.
Are we ready?
Oh, God, we've got a screen share and everything. My God.
In a world.
Hopefully, let me know if you can hear the sound. Hopefully you can. All right, let's go.
Yeah.
Oh, my God.
Come on.
Bravo. Oh, here we go. I can't hear
anything. Can't hear the sound.
Oh, no.
Take your screen share off. Set it back up, and there's a button at the bottom of it to say share screen audio.
I thought it was going to be the THX.
Fucked it up. Right, where do I do this?
So go to share screen. At the bottom, you've got a tick box in share system audio.
Right, there we go. Oh, fuck's sake. Right, let me start again.
Before you start again, what we're doing next week. Because Candy's
we're just
off.
Typing.
She's all right. She can do it later. Tell us later.
I'll decide, shall I?
Yeah.
Even though you
decide who's going to do it.
I've already decided then.
That's Candy.
We spoke about it last week. We were going to do that one and done.
No, you're
right.
Yeah.
Damn it. Share screen audio. Share. I need the audio.
I like this effort, mate. I really do.
Come on.
Here we go.
I can hear it.
Is it? Can you hear it?
Yeah, can you hear it? Yeah.
I can't hear it.
Fine.
Fine.
That's not good. No, it's not, because I need it. Right, I'm going to have to...
I'm going to put an outtakes video together for this episode.
There we go. I can hear it now.
For that reason,
I can't hear it.
We can't hear it now.
Oh, my God! It all worked fine on my computer. Right, I know why. Right, okay. Right, it's because I switched audio halfway through so I could hear it. So this now should work.
Start again and introduce it again.
Right. At least this is a YouTube video is going to be fucked.
I'll put in a like 30 years later kind of thing.
Yes.
Right.
Errors later.
Here we go. Hopefully you can hear this and we can all hear this because it's good. Right? Please tell me you can all hear it.
Yes.
Yes.
Yeah, yep. Yes, right, we're all good.
No, no, yes, yes. No, no. Yes, yes.
I'm not. I'm trying to see my notes and it keeps pausing it. This is not going well. This is not going well.
All right, on the night.
It won't. It's fucked.
I've come to a decision. I won't be.
Echoes.
Hello. Fuck.
One eternity later.
I can't see my notes. Right, ready? Let's go. Fucking hell. Right, we're all right now?
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. As you can tell by the fifth time of playing this, this is brought to you by Universal Pictures.
Oh, Paramount.
In association with modern escapism.
and
introducing the new studio developed in Hollywood. Stig Studios. So, when the tomb of the Egyptian deity covered, an ancient curse is released. Horror and devastation and death spread all over the globe. When every single statue across the world comes to life. Look at these statues. Look how awful they are. Imagine these things coming to life and wreaking havoc on the world. This is going to be awful for the listeners, so I'm going to try to describe these to you. You're really going to have to go to our YouTube channel for some of this. But look at this. We have the Verity from the UK, 65-foot statue with a huge sword. The Blue Mustang is a massive devil horse in America. 279-foot statue of the Motherland Calls in Russia. This huge woman with a massive sword. And it gets better. A Genghis Khan statue at 130-foot tall. The Guan Yu statue in China, 197-foot tall warrior statue. The death kiss. Imagine that thing coming to life and kissing you to death. How awful would that be? The crawling babies from Prague. Absolute devil. Nightmare fuel. They look like something from Silent Hill.
I'm a man.
And there's only one man that can save the day.
We are in very serious trouble.
Yes!
Sorry, didn't mean to scare you.
Your odds are not so great, O'Connell.
That's right.
Worse.
We're bringing back. Too.
I think I'll kill you.
Rick O'Connell.
We don't have time for something.
For a bit of extra.
Let's go, Jonathan.
Ladies and gentlemen, it's time for the Mummy 4. The Curse of Ptah. I think that's how you pronounce it.
I think you don't say the key.
Well, I am saying it now. Starring Brendan Fraser as Rick O'Connell. Rachel Weisz is back because the last one was terrible. So bringing back the original, Rachel Weisz is back as Evelyn. I've recruited Nicholas Holt to play Alex O'Connell because he's a better actor than the guy who was playing the son before. And he's the right age. John Hannah's back as Jonathan. And Jinju Hunts, I can't pronounce his name properly.
Jimon Honshu.
Yep, he's going to play Ptah. Daniel Brühl as Lanzo Brower.
Love
Nadia Hiker as Helena Straub. Odair Fairsback as Aradeth Bate. And David Harbour as Agent Glenn Tanner. This is your main cast for The Mummy 4. So we're going to get onto the plot. Set in 1952, a group of ex-Nazis who fled Europe have since taken new identities to look and harness control of the power of the ancient god Ptah. The opening takes place in Memphis, where researchers Lanzo Brower and his assistant Helena Straub... And is that music too loud?
Yeah.
I may just have to turn that off, but I don't know how.
Just go with it.
There you go.
Yep, I'll talk louder.
Louder.
So recruiting him. So Ptah is an ancient Egyptian deity, a creator god of patron and craftsmen and architects. In the triad of Memphis, he is the husband of Sekhmet and the father of Nefertum. I wish I'd have practiced these names. He is also regarded as the father of the sage Imhotep. So there's a bit of a link there to the other ones. The ancient Egyptians were highly skilled in art and architecture, and the masters of stoneworking, and it was all under the guidance of the god Ptah. It is believed that as the self-proclaimed creator of all things, the Ptah's powers run through all creations and craftworks on Earth, and whenever art is made, a part of him is released into them. This is me making this up, by the way. This part is me making it up for the film. Seeing that what man has done to the world when he awakens all his creations and every statue, great and small, come to life and begin to attack the human race. This also includes ancient statues which reform and take their original form. So all those destroyed statues and crumbling statues reform and turn into huge statues. Now, has anybody noticed the glaring mistake I've made with this pitch yet?
You've put statues that weren't built.
Yes. Because I thought of this concept before I decided to make it a Mummy 4, and then realised, and then I couldn't think of a way to get it around it. So what I'm doing with my film, because the Mummy takes place in an alternate world with Earth, and stuff, I can make any statue I want around the world. So there's going to be huge statues all over the world.
Does that sound like Waxworks?
Yes.
I've
missed to put all my things here. So Laszlo, he resurrects Ptah and plans to steal his power using the chalice of Amun-Ra, which is also made up. The Nazis believe that they can harness and control his power by collecting and assembling three trinkets that complete his staff. The Anker, which is life, the Jizet, which is stability, and the Was, which is dominion. Where are we next? This film is going to involve locations such as Memphis, Egypt, Bamiyan in Afghanistan, and Shanshan in Peru. And that allows us to have big set pieces with the Buddhas of Bamiyan, huge 180-foot statues, and also the Chimu statues in Peru. Where are we next? So Alex is going to be kidnapped, and he's going to end up having a love interest with Helena. Ardeth is going to get killed. He's going to sacrifice himself to save everyone else, which he was originally meant to do in The Mummy 1, but didn't. They decided to keep him alive. But this one, we're going to kill him off. Brower and Ptah assemble the staff. Brower steals his power, and in doing so, he... basically turns all of the other Nazis that followed him, all the people that are still in hiding, into huge, like, super soldier style statues. Helena doesn't like this. He told her something different, so she betrays him and frees Alex, and they have this big old fight with the statues and Brower, who, as I've also neglected to mention, that when he took Ptah's power, he also made Ptah mortal. And so him and Rick team up, and they have this big old fight with everyone, and then, yeah, they smash the chalice. Brower loses his powers, Tanner arrests him, and then Rick and your family return home. And that's The Mummy. The Curse of Ptah. Very rushed.
Very, very.
Absolutely. Oh,
effort.
That music was way too loud. So you might have to, you're going to have to do a bit of editing there, I think, Gadget.
Two glaring omissions in there, but you mentioned the statue of one. The second one, the Nazis disbanded in 1945.
Yes, did you not hear what I said at the start?
Yeah, he said he's not the one to recreate the Third Reich.
Oh, I'm into it.
I didn't say
dude,
that.
Dude, you had me at those pictures at the beginning. I was waiting for that.
Yeah, I was... and then I realised, I could do this as a mummy film. And then I realised, the mummy was set in the 20s, and then it was set in the 40s. So, but I really wanted to just do the mummy for.
Nice. Who would you have directing it?
Scott Derrickson, who did Doctor Strange, because he's
nice. Into it.
Action and horror.
So. Big into it, and globetrotting.
Yeah. So, yeah, I realised I rushed through that. I did write a lot of notes, but like the control... That's like spreadsheet as well as reading my notes.
A for effort, in my opinion.
It basically, yeah, we're going to have a bit of a globetrotting away from Egypt. So you can have some set pieces with some huge statues, you know, fighter plane, you know, the planes against the huge statues, that kind of thing. The little Chan Chan statues, they're only like
seven foot tall, aren't they?
Some of them are really small, about half the size of a human. So you could have a lot of those little ones attacking them and create like fun set pieces and all that kind of stuff.
But it's called Mummy 4. So what, who is the mummy? Is it Ptah?
Yeah, whatever.
I'm just trying to play the exec. Anyway,
they're resurrected. I like it. They find his tomb and he's a mummy. I don't know. I don't care.
We can iron out the details later.
Yeah,
it's a pitch, isn't it? It's a pitch.
I would fund it just because we're already in the Renaissance as it is. We need more of them. So, but yeah,
yeah, I like that.
It's a silly and fantastical enough idea, and I just love the idea of like the amount of megalophobia we can trigger in people with these giant statues walking around wrecking shit.
Easter Island Ed's just rolling around.
See, I had the idea.
No, like, Easter Island Ed's getting up as if like buried up to their necks and like getting off the ground.
Exactly.
It was just like, legs.
I had the idea.
Very little legs, giant heads.
And I was like, that could really work. But then I was trying to figure out how to incorporate into this one. I thought I think it would really work. And then as you can see, the plot there is just spiraling because I just kept adding on and adding on.
What about, imagine though, like the Washington Monument just turned up to be a finger sticking out the earth, and then it just became this giant colossus.
But there's there's a lot of ancient statues that obviously over time have kind of crumbled, and
back from the Denver horse,
and yeah,
that is a nightmare fueled sculpture though. Outside the airport,
some of them are like that. Those the crawling children in the crawling
that
babies in Prague.
Spider thing. What is that man, spider thing? Don't give me that.
Those baby crawly things. No thanks. Yeah.
So unless
the Yorkshire Sculpture Park will get us,
I couldn't figure out a way to bring them into the future, or I could have rebooted it. I could have rebooted it in modern day and done it. So that's the option. There's an option to either keep it in the 50s in the same kind of timeline, or reboot it with them in the modern day, so you could have those huge, like the tallest statue in the world, by the way, is about 520 foot tall.
That's ridiculous.
So yeah, imagine that coming to life.
It's like, called the Blackpool Tower,
like kaiju level style statues stomping around on your cities.
What was that first one, the one in Turkey? Was that 294 foot I saw, or something like that? Was it Turkey you showed?
Russia.
That huge thing, that looked mental.
Huge statue with a huge sword.
Do you know what though? When you've pitched that, like in my head, we ain't had that all out Indiana Jones style The Mummy romp in ages, have we?
No, we haven't.
We've got these The Rock ones where it's set in jungles and stuff like that. It's not the same.
No,
it's not the same as these swashbucklers.
I must apologise as well for my pronunciations of the foreign names there, but
you nailed it, mate.
Yeah, it was just. I wrote a lot more notes here, but then I was just kind of trying to do that after all the fuck-ups with the start. I was like, oh, no, I don't know where I am.
But so much echo, I don't even laugh halfway through it because I was laughing 900 times on the echo.
I can't hear an echo from any of you, so not too bad.
No, it's gone now. Basically, I think what you were doing is the way you were sharing your screen, you were also sharing our sound back to us.
Oh, right. Okay, well, I was sharing the other screen. But yeah, anyway, that's me. Mummy 4, The Curse of Ptah, if that's how you... Yeah, it awesome. Is Ptah, I'm pretty sure it is, because I put it...
It is Ptah, I just Googled it, so I'm sorry for correcting you.
The Chalice of Amun-Ra, I just made that up.
That'll do.
I like it.
An Axe and a Moon.
Yeah. It's a working title.
Okay, who wants to follow that one? Because that was a good pitch, that I like that a lot.
You, Gadget.
Me? Fine. You. Well, we can go from the ridiculous to the sublime now, because this is quite the opposite kind of film that I'm going to pitch.
Oscar bait.
No, not Oscar bait. But porn. Just... No, no. Why are you obsessed with Porn Boy? No, it's more that whereas Stig has gone for absolute gigantic spectacle, I've gone for something smaller.
Oh.
So my film is going to be distributed by A24.
Oh. Ooh.
On a budget of about 50 million, it's going to be a small scale, big ideas kind of film. And it's called In the Shadow of Ancients. The director I'm going to have attached to this one's Alex Garland. Mm-hmm. The director of photography is Wally Pfister, the guy who does all of Christopher Nolan films. And the soundtrack to be composed by Johnny Greenwood.
Hitting all the right notes so far.
Yeah.
Yeah, I'm into it.
I've got five principal characters that I'll highlight. There would be more characters in the film, but basically I just haven't detailed them because what I've got is an overview of everything. So in the lead role as Iara is Ana de Armas.
Yes.
Playing Noah is Oscar Isaac. Playing Alexia is Florence Pugh. Playing Matriarch Toltest is Kathy Bates. And playing Althea is Jennifer Hale.
Ooh.
Yes.
Very good.
Meryl.
So we open... by the way, I promise, you'll find some similarities to something we've talked about tonight. I promise it was not the inspiration for this, but when I read it back, I was like, shit, that sounds a bit like it. But just bear with it, all right? We open on wide open plains. There's a large, jagged mountain in the distance. A herd of strange-looking animals, think buffalo, but with extra legs and horns, are stampeding. Camera comes down on a young woman who stands in the field, in the path of these creatures, wearing tribal-style clothes. She steals herself and pulls a small jar from a pouch on her waist. She readies to throw it before she hears a shout of, Iara! And a man tackles her and pulls her away just before the stampede hits her. The jar lands on the ground and cracks, causing a plume of smoke to emerge. One of the beasts inhales it and collapses to the ground, asleep, while the rest of the herd runs away. The man gets up. He's older. He's bearded. He scolds her for her recklessness. She tries to argue back that she knew what she was doing, and if only she could perfect the formula, she could make hunting safer for the tribe. He tells her that she needs to stop with witchcraft, that the gods will take her from him like they took her mother. The pair return to their small town. Think of a post-apocalypse kind of thing going on here. So lots of wooden huts and kind of mud-built buildings, lots of houses and kind of communal areas, and people working together for the common good. And it seems relatively peaceful. The people are very pious, making offerings to a statue of a woman in the middle of the town, outside the central temple. Matriarch Toltest scolds Iara in front of the tribe for her behavior, telling her to stop wasting her time with alchemy and tinkering with tools, and she's not pulling her weight for the tribe. She warns that the constant chasing of technology and alchemy will displease the gods and lead to the tribe's downfall, causing people to look on displeased with her. And Toltest warns her father, Noah, that her behavior won't be tolerated and he would be punished too. Later, Iara is sitting alone looking up at the stars. And for any eagle-eyed viewers, they'd see the stars don't look like the ones we see on Earth. She's interrupted from her thoughts by her friend Alexia, who encourages her to keep making things, that her gadgets and gizmos help the tribe and that Toltest is an old fool. She points out that if she keeps working on the water collecting gizmo she keeps talking about, then she can really help the tribe to irrigate crops and famines won't be so common. Iara laments the way traditions are adhered to so strongly, saying that she knows the Toltest will order her irrigation device to be destroyed if she ever finishes it, and claim it's an affront to I and the tribe's way of life, no matter how useful it is. Alexia counters that traditions are important, but even Toltest cannot stand in the way of something so useful to the tribe, and she definitely can't stand in the way of progress. Iara looks out to a mountain, the jagged mountain in the distance. She asks Alexia if she wants to try climbing it soon. Alexia looks worried and reminds that the last person to try and climb the mountain never returned, not to mention that it is forbidden. Iara remains unperturbed by this. As time goes on, within the town, disquiet starts to fester. The harvests are down, there is a start of the famine, and the populace are blaming the gods, and by proxy, Toltest. She counters back that they are of poor faith, and that by questioning the gods, they themselves bring their own ruin. She tells them the words of the great eye told of times of conservation, times of prosperity, and times of pain. It mollifies people for a little while, but Nora is worried. We cut a little, we're going to jump a little bit ahead in the story here. We cut to Iara and Alexia reaching the mountain. Iara having convinced her to go, finally. They start their journey up the mountain. Back at the village, tensions continue to build, and the matriarch tries to institute stricter control, causing people to start to try and rebel. She seals herself away in the temple and instructs her honor god to control it with strength, resulting in violence. Back at the mountain, Iara and Alexia climb. Iara tries to hammer a hook into the stone, but it bends and won't go in. When she pulls the damaged hook away, the rock crumbles down and below, and left behind is shiny and silver. She hits it with a hammer and it makes a hollow thudding sound. As she's explaining this to Alexia, the wind starts to whip up and the weather turns. Alexia suggests they turn back, but Iara loses her grip and falls, crashing through rock and disappearing into the darkness. In the village, things have gotten worse. Taltas guards have forced people back to their homes, patrolling and attacking people who are seen in the open. Nora is trying to keep people from fighting during a secret meeting, but people are convinced that Taltas has forsaken them in the eyes of the gods. Alexia bursts in and tells Nora that Iara fell whilst climbing the mountain and is missing. Nora immediately manages to convince some friends to follow him to the mountain to look for her. This gets back to Taltas, and she warns Nora and his friends that if they step foot on the mountain, they will be banished and cast out along with all of their descendants. Nora tells her to fuck off and that his daughter is more important. Iara wakes up in darkness with a cough. She gets up screaming in pain as her arm is badly broken. She tries to move around, bumping into a wall that feels metal. She feels something smooth which lights up with unfamiliar text. She recoils from horror. She recoils in horror from it. And she looks at it again and just dabs a finger on it. And the room lights up and a door slides open. She looks around as the corridors around her lights up. Metal bulkheads, pale blue light. She starts to explore around, finding empty rooms, lots of which are destroyed. But she finds remnants of people's lives. Pictures of people who look like her in unfamiliar clothes and strange places. She walks into a cavernous room filled with tubes as far as the eye can see. She wipes the frost off one to see a person inside. Horrified, she runs, but she's hopelessly lost. She ends up in a room filled with beds. A strange female voice talks to her, asks if she can help. Iara is scared and asks if this is one of the gods or is it I speaking. The voice says she is Althea, the premier AI of the Everspace Colonial Agency. Althea tells her she's in the medical bay and as she places her arm on the table, she can heal her injury. Iara reluctantly agrees as she watches, amazed as a pair of small robot arms swish over her broken arm, refuse the bone, leaving her pain-free. Althea guides Iara through the facility, which she explains is a colony ship named Seed, sent from a place called Earth thousands of years or so earlier. Due to sabotage from the Earth Purity terrorists, the ship crash-landed rather than entering orbit as intended. As per protocol, Althea had awakened a handful of crew to establish a local base, but none of them returned. Until she had confirmation the planet was habitable, she was not willing to wake up any more of the complement of people. Nora and his group reach the base of the mountain, pursued by Taltas and her retinue. Being told that touching the mountain is blasphemy, Nora starts to climb and Taltas tells her men to get him. Nora's friends tell him to go look for Lara, they'll hold them off, and Nora starts to head up the mountain. Iara learns more about the technology of Earth. The planet was poisoned by centuries of human progress, and the planet was effectively evacuated with colony ships heading hundreds of planets across the galaxy. Seed was to be the first and the biggest, holding some 100,000 souls to be released over the space of 5 years as a colony was set up. Althea shows her the terraforming technology and then shows her the stores of food and suspended animation. Althea detects people climbing the mountain and Iara sees her father. He's being chased by Taltas goons. Althea opens a door and Lara pulls him in. They are reunited and Iara tells him of what she's learned. They wait for Taltas and her goons to leave and then follow back down to the village, explaining what they've found and that they are born of the stars and that it's not because the gods exist, but because of a people more advanced than them who came to this planet to build a better life. Iara brings evidence, but Taltas disregards it, calling them heathens. Tells him to execute him, but they don't listen to her. They listen to Iara. Nora confronts Taltas, demands to know why the mountain was forbidden, why it was blasphemous. Taltas is forced to confess that she is born of the Earth Purity figures who survived the crash, that they find evidence in her private chambers of the line of propaganda that used to keep people of learning the truth of their origin, of learning of space travel. If they couldn't have the Earth, and only the Earth, this people would be kept ignorant of the stars and not know of the technology hidden in the mountain, or rather the ship. The secret of the colony ship was worth killing for, and anyone who ventured into the mountain were killed at her and her ancestors' orders. The people are enraged that they've had to suffer famine and hardship when there is technology to farm and stores of food so close to them. And there are 100,000 people in a state of undeath who have missed centuries because of her and her ancestors' selfishness and pettiness, and she is ejected from the village. Iara and Noah return to the seed and ask for Althea's help. After helping to repair some systems and redirecting power around the seed, Althea starts to wake up crew members and they are introduced to each other. We cut forward 5 years. The village still exists as it was, but around it there is industrialized agriculture, machines helping people work. The famine is over, the population has increased. And Iara sets up the water collection device Alexia had mentioned before, only for Alexia to interrupt her and ask why she isn't working with the new technology. And she says sometimes the old ways are best, especially when they can be enjoyed alongside the new things.
Fucking spoiler alert.
You wanted a film, bitch.
Lovely. It was the plot to Horizon Forbidden West, but you've not played it, so you can't have plagiarized it. Well done, mate. That was epic.
That is an absolute epic. I was getting Patrick Ness vibes as well. It's a little bit Knife of Never Letting Go.
I was getting some Westworld vibes as well in a weird way.
Yeah, I can see that, yeah. And this is why I was saying in our kind of private chats, like, I think I might have actually accidentally found my new book doing this.
It sounds like it.
I mean, there's no ending now. You fucking spoiled it.
Yeah, you're going to have to change it now.
Yeah, Jesus. Yeah, it's definitely a Rise of Forbidden West, that, mate.
Is it? Shit.
you might get sued by Guerrilla Games. But again, you've not played it, so you can't plagiarize that.
It was when I was starting talking about the tribal stuff and then getting into technology, I thought, oh, shit, this is the first Horizon game.
What did you call it again?
It's called In the Shadow of Ancients.
Ooh. That or The Mummy 4.
I mean, they can exist in the same world. It's not a competition.
No, I do like it because it gave me Planet of the Apes vibes as well. The original ones, the Charlton Heston. You maniacs!
I mean, it's slightly communist as well. You know, it's trying to...
You know I'm into that.
Getting over oppression.
Yeah.
For the good of everybody.
That's great. I enjoyed that. I'd definitely watch that.
I mean, I've seen it.
Both very good so far.
I've watched it now. You're shitting yourself now, big, aren't you? Because you've done a paragraph. All the way through that, when Stig did his, and Gadget did his, biggest face is like, fuck.
So that was my pitch. We'll move on to... I tell you, we'll leave Biggie till last, so he's got time to finish his homework on the bus to school.
I'm done, but yeah, I don't know where it's going to go. We're going.
Oodles, what have you got?
Not as verbose and grand as you two, but something I want to watch. This is called The Bastard 66.
Oh.
Brackets, parentheses, or whatever, comma, The Battle for Gods and Country. Directed by Quentin Tarantino.
Oh, God.
A stylistic historical black comedy / drama epic about the rise of William the Bastard and his campaign to take what was promised to him by God. Unbeknownst to William, two other men were promised the throne of England before the death of King Edward the Confessor. Hadrada, the Norse Viking king, was promised a throne by the last Viking king of England, and Harold Godwinson, the rightful heir to the throne and last of the Anglo-Saxons. Will these hurdles stop William the Bastard in his tracks to becoming the legendary William the Conqueror? Or not? That's the pitch. So, it's Battle of Hastings, guys. Fucking hell, come on.
I'm just wondering who Samuel L. Jackson's going to play in this.
Get ready. So, William the Bastard, played by Michael Fassbender. Come on.
Yeah, I can see that.
His wife, Matilda of Flanders, played by Margot Robbie. Come on.
Naturally.
Ronkier.
Tarantino loves
King surfies. Harold God... Yeah, exactly. King Harold Godwinson, played by Tim Roth. His wife, Queen Edith, played by Uma Thurman.
All right.
Hadrada, the Viking King of Norway, played by Mads Mikkelsen.
Yes, his wife.
His wife, Tora Torberg's daughter, played by Margaret Qualley.
Yeah.
Your Viking of the Berserker, played by Brad Pitt, the emissary of Hadrada. King Edward the Confessor, the Dying King, played by Walton Goggins. And playing the Pope, Alexander II, is Christoph Waltz, the Pope that sparked the imagination into William, telling him it is the God's will that he should become the King of England. Runtime, approximately 4 hours and 5 minutes.
Yep, standard.
Supporting cast: Stellan Skarsgård as the Viking Seer, Jamie Foxx as the Garnian Partridge, a deadly warrior, which is an accurate historical figure. Michael Madsen as Chaplain Bill Stone. Austin Butler as the town crier of Stamford Bridge. Michael J. Fox as the Archbishop of Canterbury. And Samuel L. Jackson as Sir Gideon of Hastings. Budget of $100 billion. Production company, Columbia Pictures. That's about all I've got. I just think it's Mint the Bastard 66. It's one of those historical films with like hip hop in it.
Sold again.
You know where I'm going. You know where I'm going with it.
The idea of Samuel Jackson's Gideon of Hastings walking around calling everyone motherfuckers. I like it.
Yeah, motherfucker. That's it.
How many characters are going to get their bare feet out of?
All of them, because they don't wear shoes back then. They're Anglo-Saxons.
I think they did.
They did.
Or sandals. You see the toes. I just think it'd be good, like, William the Bastard all the way through. We all know at the end it becomes William the Conqueror. He wins, but it's a Tarantino film. It might not. We've seen
Tarantino doing a historical epic.
As a sequel, was William the Conqueror
the Glorious Bastard?
He did. Was William the Conqueror that exploded when at his own funeral?
No,
because that could be a good ending.
Maybe, I don't know. I didn't get that far.
I'm sorry. Can you explain your ending?
So I think it was William the Conqueror. He
it was Harold Godwinson that got the arrow to the eye, didn't he? In the Battle of Hastings. I'm changing it around.
Hope I'm not related.
William the Bastard gets an arrow in the eye and he pulls it out. And he's got an eye patch and it's cool. And yeah, he's got to become William the Conqueror because it's cool, isn't it?
Yeah, apparently William the Conqueror exploded.
Well, there we go. That's the credits, the end credits. It just explodes.
So yeah, so I'll add to this. So he treated his people very, very badly, and he was at literal war with his son. So when he died, no one really did anything about it. Some knight, I think, took his body about 70-odd miles in the middle of the summer, transported it back, and they had a funeral. And sure enough, his body was in pretty bad condition at that point, and they couldn't get him into the coffin, so they're just trying to smush it down. And then he exploded.
I'm getting you on board to direct that scene for me.
Yes.
But the thing is, we've got France, we've got England, we've got Norway. It's going to be good. 4 hours, guys. It's going to be incredible.
It'll be really interesting to see Tarantino handle historical dialogue.
Well, he did Slave Era America, didn't he, and stuff like that, and the
it did not sound like Slave Era America. Though.
No,
it
I know.
Like
that's
Tarantino
what I'm saying.
Going
this
off
is
and
not going to sound like that either. They're all going to have American accents.
Yeah,
and stuff.
But then you get run the risk of getting like Guy Ritchie's Sword in the Stone, King Arthur.
No. It's not like that. It's
King Arthur, that kind of shit.
It's Tarantino. It's more tongue in cheek. They're going to argue about burgers and stuff.
They call it ye olde burger and cheese.
Exactly.
Say, oh yeah, yeah, again, motherfucker.
That's it. You're getting the vibes. It's something that people would watch.
I mean, I'd watch it because it's Tarantino, and I pretty much watch everything of his. I just struggle to see it.
Doesn't he always direct stuff that he's written or someone else has written? Like, he's not done anything like that, has he, before? The Glorious Bastards was obviously created by him. That's not based on reality. So, I mean...
He didn't write Jackie Brown, and he directed that.
This is what I'm saying.
True, is it? He's, like you say, historical stuff. He's never done anything like that at all.
This is going to be away from the actual facts. It's not factual. This is just based on it. You know what I mean? All names in this production are fictional, but they're not. Do you know what I mean? When they have that little warning.
They're literally not.
I know. But, yeah. It's
literally not based on a true story.
In Glorious Bastards, they shot Adolf Hitler with a machine gun loads. Do you know what I mean? That never happened.
No,
it's
going to
be like that. It's going to be like that. It's going to be daft. It's going to be, like I say, a black comedy. Drama. Like, imagine, like, fucking William the Bastard, like, just getting onto Hastings and having a big line of cocaine and going, come on, let's go.
Well, I tell you what, let's get on the phone to Tarantino and see what he's doing this summer, see if he's free to do that one.
Telling you.
Friend of the show.
Columbia, snap it up.
Film it on location in Hastings.
No, it's going to be filmed in like America or Canada, isn't it? That's what they always do. So yeah, that's my pitch, and I really like it.
I think actually, I like it too. It's surreal, but I kind of want to see it.
66. Yeah.
Candy, what have you got for us?
I will tell you. So I'm going to set the scene. So the starting scene, we open up in a war-torn world of an alternate 2030, panned down from a red nuclear-scorched sky to a burnt-out and crumbling White House. In front of the White House, there's a sarcophagus of G.I. Jane, the U.S.'s finest war hero, with a burning American flag flying behind it. As a wayward bomb drops towards the White House, a female hand punches through the roof of the sarcophagus, grabbing the bomb before it makes contact with the earth and just crushing it. And roll titles for G.I. Jane Eyre, which, and kind of Terminator-style music in the background. So are you with me so far? Exactly. So before I properly start, I'd like to categorically state that by no means did I think of a title I liked and worked a film around it, and I'm 100% familiar with both G.I. Jane and Jane Eyre. So yeah, this is a sort of spiritual sequel to the film G.I. Jane, starring G.I. Jane and a G.I. hijinks of being Jane.
I do like how you say war hero, but she never actually went to war in that film.
I didn't see it. Shh. I like the title.
It's a good title. Carry on.
I'm just guessing what happens in the film. So after her military training, Jane suffered an untimely death defending her country. Her body was all but destroyed. Her brain remained active. Given that she was an asset to the US military, her consciousness was transferred into a T-800 style robot, which gave her back her original appearance and organic looking skin, which covered a steel war machine underneath. And she was laid to rest with the intentions of being reactivated in times of great peril for the USA, and that day has arrived. So back to the opening scene, a futuristic helicopter-style drone swoops down to pick up the now standing robot G.I. Jane, covered in rags and everything, arms still up in the air, and takes her off to a secret military facility. She's told that the purpose of her reactivation is to travel back in time to give past leaders a glimpse into the future of what was to come and to change the trajectory towards a life of peace. Now, as she's being sent back through time, the military facility is stormed by the baddies, yet to be disclosed. I don't know who the baddies are going to be, some other country. And the time machine operative is injured as he's typing in his time, destination, and location. Instead of sending her back to America in 1985, the operative falls onto the keyboard and accidentally sends her back to England in 1785.
So a different location as well.
Yeah. He managed to fall on the keys that spelled out England.
The move stick.
Yeah, so it's point pitch.
That's where it was. Yeah.
It's where it was at the time.
Exactly. Yes, exactly. So the drone that had originally picked her up is the actual time machine. And as it crashes to Earth, G.I. Jane realises something is very wrong. She's outside a manor house surrounded by fields and horses and people with English accents. Above the door of the manor, the name Reed is carved into the brick. As she picks herself up, a man in white frilly shirt and riding breeches runs towards her. She grabs him by the throat and states, "I need your clothes and your horse." "Well, this will never do," Mr. Reed replies. "We must find you ladies' garments." So they dress her up in an appropriately frumpy dress and bonnet and set about sort of learning her history. He and Mrs. Reed's played by Dame Maggie Smith. She immediately takes a disliking to her. They sort of surmise that she must be suffering some kind of terrible amnesia or brain disease and set about teaching her the ways of living as a modern 1700s lady of the country. So Mr. and Mrs. Reed, who ask her to refer to them as aunt and uncle, decide to send her to Lowood Institution, which is a mental institution for women, after Jane continually tries to fix a time machine and steals items from the house and tries to put it back together. And Mrs. Reed is obsessed with foiling her plans and abuses her and berates her whenever she can and generally tries to prevent her from exploring the house further or making any mention or attempt to fix a time machine. So this, they call it a school. The school is run by the nefarious Dr. Brocklehurst, who takes a particular interest in her and her so-called ramblings. During her time at the Lowood Institute or school, she suffers oppression, which kind of brings back memories of her training as a GI. During her time in the institution, she slowly learns what it is to be a woman in these times and her role and how to blend in. During the night, she sneaks out to work on the time machine, stealing items from Lowood Institution that might help fix the machine and send her to the correct time. The school has a suspiciously large science department for a girls' school, and there seems to be many blocked-off doors that no one seems to know where they lead. One night, while experimenting with ammonium chloride, a chemical reaction goes wild and creates an instant ice within like a 10-meter radius, directly in line with the young man riding his horse. The horse slips and ice, throwing the rider off. Jane helps him back onto his horse and learns his name is Mr. Rochester. The two of them often sneak out to meet each other at the time machine and form a strong romantic bond. Meanwhile, several unexplained goings-on have been occurring in the Lowood Institute, such as strange laughter coming from behind the blocked doors, random attacks on other inmates, and a mysterious fire in the room Mr. Rochester was hiding out in that night. Jane manages to save Mr. Rochester from the fire, and then there's a 15-minute sex scene. Like in
15 minutes.
So it's
Terminator 1.
Yeah, so it's kind of a montage of the two of them bonking and sort of working on the time machine together until it's.
I believe when it's a man on machine, it's called clanking.
God, clanking! Yes, 15 minutes of clanking. So they work together. So the time machine's almost fixed, basically, in between bonks, clanks. Sometime later, Dr. Brocklehurst gives Jane the news that Mrs. Reed has had a stroke and that she's needed back at the house. Dr. Brocklehurst gives her a lift in his horse-drawn carriage. When she gets to the house, she's greeted by Mrs. Reed, who is in a fully weaponized mech suit, who reveals that she's also a robot. sent from the future to stop her getting the message back to the 80s.
Put her down, you bitch.
Now, Dr. Brocklehurst has been in on it the entire time, and Lowood Institution is actually a secret military facility that was sent back about 10 years before Jane arrived to get everything set up to stop her.
Why?
So Mr. Rochester, meanwhile, so they're traveling back to see Mrs. Reed. Mr. Rochester, meanwhile, he sneaked onto the back of the carriage as it was traveling and discovered that the carriage itself was some kind of transformer like mech type thing. Nice. He recognized the onboard computer from his time helping Jane fix a time machine. In the time it took them to travel back to the manor, he'd tinkered with the computer and secretly programmed to do his and Jane's will. So as Dr. Brocklehurst and Mrs. Reed reveal their true identities, Mr. Rochester sends one of the horses out to kick Dr. Brocklehurst in the head, killing him instantly. Mr. Rochester then takes control of the mech to fight alongside Jane. So he's in the mech, Jane's a robot, and then they're both fighting against Mecha Reed. So it all kicks off, basically. They have the upper hand, and they're about to win. Mrs. Reed initializes a self-destruct sequence. So she knows she's going to die anyway. So it's like a projectile. It sends her body smashing towards Jane. Mr. Rochester jumps in the way and he's killed, basically. Jane screams, no, because now she knows what it is, how you love like a human. She's
basically Kyle Reese, isn't it?
Exactly.
I know
so,
now why you love.
That's exactly, yeah, that's smiling. What she said. So Mr. Rochester is dead, but the battle is won. Jane turns to Mecha Reed and discovers that the missing chemical she needs to travel through time there in the mech suit. She takes it along with Mr. Rochester's body and fixes the time machine. She travels back to the moment the wrong time is programmed into the time machine and she kills all the baddies. And then they create a robot body for Mr. Rochester and together they travel back to 1985. Where they should have been in the first place to warn them that war is coming. And then they live happily ever after. So
wow.
I want this to be directed by Michael Bay. And it's starring Kristen Stewart as G.I. Jane Eyre. Colin Firth as Mr. Rochester. Bit of an age gap. Yeah. We don't mind. She's a robot. Dame Maggie Smith as Mecha Reed. And Patrick Stewart as Dr. Brocklehurst. And the budget's maybe 120 million. I don't know about film budgets.
Is it a Paramount film?
No, I'm going to say it's going to be an asylum film. But it's serious, though. Well. It's not a piss take.
Oh, no, mate. Of course not.
I have questions.
G.I. Jane Eyre. Are you having
I have questions about your sanity, Candy.
You're only now you're asking smoking. About my sanity.
Why did they bother sending something back?
A military
preparation for her to land in 1700s.
Yeah, I wanted to know
because they knew it was going to happen. You see, because the baddies took over and they saw that she'd gone back to that time, and they couldn't take the risk. So they sent them back 10 years before.
If they just left
time doesn't
there,
work
though,
like
then...
that.
Well, no, because they knew that she was she could have built a time machine again. She's a robot. She knows her shit.
Oh, I think the correct answer is candy. So the plot can happen.
Exactly. Because
just
plot.
Because.
I think you smoked too much reefer, mate.
I have to say, that might have been involved whilst I was thinking of the story.
Genuinely. She's just lay on this fucking devil's lettuce.
So surreal.
Well, the best films are.
I know how your brain worked. You're like that, tooting on your devil lettuce. G.I. Jane Eyre. Now, let's make a film out of that.
That was it. That is exactly what happened.
Jesus Christ.
But you can't say it's not a good film. I would sometimes watch the devil's lettuce.
When you said like, I would G.I. watch Jane, it just to say I've watched
battle hardened veteran. G.I. Jane wasn't a battle hardened veteran. And that's
yeah, but
the
she is at this point. She's been oh, through yeah. wars now. It's she trained as a G.I. Since... She got sent out. She's seen shit. You don't know what's happened in the meantime.
I do. I've seen the film.
No, after the film.
Yeah, you don't know what happens at the end, clearly.
She becomes G.I. Jane and shaves her hair off. Yes, she does.
So it wouldn't be...
She tries
it
again.
It wouldn't be Demi Moore then?
No, we're going
Kristen
with it.
Kristen Stewart was probably about 8 when that came out.
Yeah, it's yeah. coming out now. Well, so my film's coming out now. So she still has to look young because she's a robot.
She?
Yeah.
She rocks a skinhead.
She rocks her skin out. She still has to look young because she's been a robot for the last like 50
and
years or whatever.
She acts a bit like a robot, doesn't she?
Exactly. It's perfect.
I've seen that last Twilight film.
You say that so accusingly.
Wow. That the sad thing is, I've seen Twilight and not G.I. Jane.
Yeah, that is that.
Absolutely phenomenal, Caddy. Love it.
Thank you.
We need posters made up for all these films, especially.
I've got a poster of mine. I was going to drop it on the day of the episode.
Biggie.
Right, that's our homework then.
Yeah. You're better than me.
Okay.
Let's
guys.
Hear what you've got.
I'm so sorry for this. You have to bear with me. Okay, so setting the scene, the movie's about to start. The Capcom logo pops up on the screen.
Oh, no.
Oh, yes. Picture the scene. A picturesque Japanese background. As a drone flies across a busy metropolis of Tokyo, weaving in between business districts and shops, bustling with people until we fly past these suburbs and eventually pan across mountains and hills until we come across a calm lake with beautiful blossom trees aligned along the way. Hold on.
The end.
Yeah. Well, thanks for watching. And as the drone, the helicopter with the camera flies across the lake, comes across and pans down onto three figures below in a small outlook of the woods.
I know where we're going.
Jen is observing a sparring match between two young boys, Ryu and Ken, as the camera zips in and out of the boys as they block, punch, and kick in symmetry. And as the fight goes on, with all the cameras zooming in and out of all the punches and kicks, the boys start to age until we come to present day. Jen steps in with words of wisdom, instructing and critiquing each one until it becomes a grudge fight, as each one wants to be the better than the other. Suddenly, during the fight, Ken decides to perform an Hadouken out of nowhere. Ryu quickly moves in to counter with his own. The two balls of energy clash and explode into the Street Fighter logo. Of course it is. We have Street Fighter World Warriors, the movie.
Okay. Yes.
So, my casting. You have Iko Uwai, I hope that's how you pronounce his name, as Ryu. Now, you're going to have to bear with me on this because I struggle to think of anyone that could look like Ken Masters who can do martial arts in movies. So I did a bit of research. It turns out that Ryan Philippe, of all people, is a martial artist and has a belt.
He also hasn't done a film in ages, has he?
He's like 60 now.
There you go. No, he's not, actually. He's 1 year younger than me. Thanks very much.
At 60, then.
Wow.
Shut up.
This is the guy from Cruel Intentions, isn't it?
It is.
So 47-year-old Ryan Philippe is paying 20-year-old Ken.
No, they're older. They're a bit older.
Okay.
So
round two.
Street Fighter, the retirement years.
You've got Sagat, You got The Rock.
Yes.
You got Vega, Timothy Chalamet. We have Chun Li as Yanin Zheja. She is, if you don't know who she is, she's a martial artist. She's awesome. Thai, I think. Akuma is Dave Bautista. Jen is Jackie Chan.
Obviously.
Zangief is played by, I don't know where I'm going to go with this name. It's Hafor Julius Bjornsson from The Man Mountain. From Game of Thrones.
Thor.
Guile is played by Channing Tatum.
Of course he is.
M. Bison is Michael Fassbender.
He's busy. He's busy on Bastard 66.
I was going to have Blanca in, and I was going to have Andy Serkis do all the acting of him being a bit of a creature.
Yes.
And then have a martial artist, obviously, doing all the moves, but I couldn't work him into the story, so he's not actually in the story. Dowson was going to be Kunal Nainar from The Big Bang Theory.
Who's that?
Raj from The Big Bang Theory and fucking Street Fighter.
You need somebody that looks... Anyway, so then you're going to go
Kamal
on with...
Nanjinani or someone like
that. Yeah, who's got action hero training for Eternals.
Which I haven't seen.
Yeah, but he's fucking ripped in that.
But I haven't seen it. I don't know. I haven't seen the movie.
Rough.
Anyway, we go back to the story. So
Dev from Coronation Street as Dal Sim. Ridiculous,
so,
mate.
As we return to the fighters on the ground, both were knocked back from the explosion, exhausted. Jen comes over, angry at the two for losing their focus and using the dangerous skills that they've learned, tells them he is now too old for this. He feels that although they have mastered the art, they have not learned the common sense, and warns them of the dangers of these powers. He tells them to leave. He's done with this. The two apologize. He asks them both to leave and only return when they have the true meaning of being a master. They collect their belongings and begrudgingly leave. They say their goodbyes to each other and go separate ways. Ken heads back to the States for fame and fortune. Ryu says that he's not interested and wants to follow a different path. Then Q, a TV advert promoting the World Warriors tournament. It's being held in Vegas and is like this pay-per-view gold. Fighters, you know, is this big, massive advert going on. So you're actually watching it as if you're watching it on TV. Fighters from around have been invited to compete. By Shadaloo Corporation, a media network that has connections almost everywhere. They're a bit like Apple, but not as sinister. The combatants are not very, not just well-trained fighters, but rich men and women from around the world who are bored with having everything and wish to prove themselves in these tournaments. Chun-Li, we find out, is a police officer from China. She's entered the ring undercover to find out what happened to her father, a lawyer who was investigating the company for reasons and disappeared. Each character that we're introduced into has something to prove as we're introduced to the main cast and their basic goals. So, for example, Giles just come back from tour of duty, has no work available, sees the ad, feels like that's something he wants to go and do. Bear with me on this. Bison is obviously corrupt. And the betting...
Sorry, I've got questions.
But Bison is corrupt and betting on the fights is clearly rigged. He discovers this. And that he's been using a business as a front to deal with even more nefarious stuff like profitable drugs, guns, and money. They're all the bad stuff. My notes have just
moved. You mean the platform of the first film, yeah?
Probably. let me have a look here. While she's investigating, she's caught behind the scenes by Sagat. But all of a sudden, Gal had observed her sneaking off, wondered what she was up to, follows her, manages to convince Sagat that she was in the wrong place and wrong time and manages to somehow get them away. I haven't really thought about this. She was due to fight shortly, so her pay-per-view match was changed last minute and it turns into a cage match against Vega. It's a brutal fight, and due to some smarts, she ends up surviving the fight and takes him out. And then we have different other fights. Ken versus Lee, Gal versus E. Honda, all the others. Ryu and Sagat has a massive fight. It turns out that Sagat's losing, so then... Due to his rage, he calls the henchmen to jump in and fight. Ken decides he's coming to support Ryu as well. They will end up in a big fight. After the main event, Chun-Li opens up to Gal about what she was actually doing. He offers to try and help her. Ken and Ryu catch up after the fight. They hear a ruckus in the hotel room, and it turns out that Chun-Li is being arrested by Sagat and the henchmen to try and take her away from meddling in affairs. A corridor fight ensues between them. There's really tight corridor fights and in the hotel room. All really cool. When they come back, we're introduced to Bison. He accuses Chun-Li of meddling in affairs that don't concern her because everyone loves a good meddling. That he killed her father. Chun-Li accuses him of the corruption, which he not only accepts, but goes on to explain how he's become so powerful and yada, yada, yada. All the fights are rigged. The fighters are threatened with blackmail, or their families are kidnapped to ensure the results are as they are so that everybody makes big money behind the scenes. They're shown Giles, Bunny, and Jen have been beaten up. They're told to throw the fight or they will be killed. Ryu then suddenly uses his Hadouken to break his cuffs. Ken follows suit, and there turns out to be a big fight between everybody. Sagat, Akuma's
there. It was a big fight, no way.
Another big fight. More fighting, lots of fights. Ryu finally breaks away, aims for Bison. As he attempts to fight Bison, Bison uses his own power, his Psycho Smasher on him, and turns Ryu evil Ryu. Ryu suddenly turns around and ends up taking on Ken. He defeats Ken. Gold tries to help Chun-Li to escape, and he ends up being killed by both Sagat and Akuma. Chun-Li tries to fight her way out, but ends up trying to take on as many goons as she can to escape. She gets smashed into a room, and it turns out...
into a big fight.
And she stumbles into a room where she finds Jen and Charlie. And then it turns out that Charlie is revealed to be Donnie Yen. And then that's it.
Charlie Blanca.
Charlie Blanca's Donnie Yen.
And then at the end, hang on, bear with me. And that is where it ends, because it's now set up for part two where we find out how they escape and what happens to Ken and Ryu.
Mate, right, you've just done the plot to all the Street Fighter films. You know there's 8 Street Fighter films, and you've just mashed them all together.
Apart from this time, Ryu turns bad and fights Ken rather than Ken turning bad and fighting Ryu.
You've literally just got eight films and just turned them into your own film.
Why did you change Gurken to Jen?
Yeah.
Gurken is their master.
No, the names are
Jen is Chun-Li's father's friend.
Yeah.
Who's the old guy with the big long moustache?
No, that's Gurken is the master who trains Ryu and Ken.
Well, that's the one I wanted.
I can't believe we just made Street Fighter again.
Oh my God. That's the title of it. Street Fighter again.
The director is by Gareth Evans. So he knows how to do action scenes. So all these fights that happen are going to be so cool as fuck. They're all tight. They're going to be done properly. And the plot, no one cares about the plot, but at least it will have some form of a plot, because it's going to be all about the awesome fight scenes, which no Street Fighter movie has ever done.
Guys, huh? The animated manga is the best one.
That's the one I've seen. I've definitely seen that one.
You've seen them all by the sounds of it.
I haven't.
I have, and you've just copied them all.
I haven't seen them.
That's the plot to Street Fighter 4, the game.
That's how easy it's clearly easy to write a Street Fighter movie.
Yeah,
plot.
You just go with the ultimate fight.
You should have had a plot twist at the end, and Heihachi Mishima from Tekken walks in and they have a big fight.
No, they're not even connected.
Or Spider-Man appears and you get Marvel versus Capcom.
Yeah, exactly.
But I'm afraid that's what I had. But the cast is incredible.
Why did you put Channing Tatum in as Gal when John Cena is right there?
Because although John Cena is a wrestler, Channing Tatum is also a trained martial artist.
Yeah, a trained dancer as well.
Mm-hmm. I just want to see John Cena with the hair.
Because the problem with anything to do with Street Fighter is that the fighting is shit. Considering it's based on a game about fighting, you want someone that can direct action movies. You want action stars.
Some of them are fantastic.
You can do them, so
The Rock is Sagat, though.
Come on, mate, seriously, how cool would that be?
You know Sagat's from like Sri Lanka or Indonesia.
Thailand,
that's it.
It doesn't matter, half of these actors in these movies are always from the same place. You bring in Tatum
because he's a martial artist, but The Rock isn't a martial artist.
You can't go
because it's about the fighting.
You can't go casting American, like Samoan man, The Rock, as a Thai fighter.
But I just have.
I got uppercut.
You can't cast The Rock.
See,
as a
in my film, I did correct.
Bloke that works
casting.
For Interpol, chasing down Germans people that for drive Germans, fast cars.
Africans for Africans, you know.
Exactly.
Oh yeah, no, I understand that, but it's really hard to find certain fighters of a certain build, a certain look, to fit a certain role.
You get nobodies. So that's how they do it.
They need to fight. And that's why the films are shit, because the people aren't very good at acting. These people are good at what they
do. I'll have you know, Van Damme, when he crashes through on his tank, you are all under arrest. That is perfect guile. American guile.
The worst. I'm sorry. It is the worst. I have seen that, and that sucks.
And Kylie Minogue is entirely correct for Cammy.
And The Legend of Chun-Li. Have you seen that film? Look like Cammy, you have, because you've just done half the plot of it.
Do you know who would have... I mean, it's not correct, like... casting in terms of nationality, but back, do you remember Tong Po?
Yeah,
yeah, like he looks like Into Sagat the fist, in that film. Yeah, in that film, he looks like Sagat.
Oh, yeah, he does, yeah,
yeah.
Give but me Tong Po.
You see him now, he just doesn't look anything like
you
that.
You kill my brother,
but yeah, it was all about the fighting for me. So Gareth Evans is doing the directing, it would have been an awesome, awesome action movie.
For you,
I would have been happy watching that. Let's be honest.
I won't waste a cinema trip for Street Fighter 9.
Fantastic. Well, thank you, everyone. Thank you for being creative for this one, because I know I put a lot onto you, and that was incredible. Like, so Excellent. Many different takes on how things come across, and so surreal from all of you. I love it.
What I want to know, though, Gadget, if our lovely listeners have got just as much creative juices as Biggie has.
They do, actually. There's some really surprisingly good ones in here. So,
Street Fighter 9?
Well, how about you listen to this one? Because we're starting off with Planty.
Uh-oh.
And he said, I am legend, except all the vampires are Peter Kay.
What does he mean?
Remember Other Room in Contact? Remember when your dog weren't dead? How about the seafood man that came around the club? Will Smith takes his own life 10 minutes into the film.
That's funny. Imagine being last man on earth and then Peter Kay turns up. I'd hate it. Or many Peter Kays.
Many Peter Kays.
That's awful. Oh, yes,
nice little insight into Planty's mind there.
You just hear that rumble of remember, coming in the distance.
Garlic bread.
You're just walking down the abandoned streets of New York. You see. Bread.
In his big blue shirt bread. He wears. Get back, you bastards, I'll break your legs.
That kind of all spitting. That shape, yeah.
It's spitting.
Yeah, they don't come out when it's raining.
It's a lot of Peter Kays running down the street going, it's spitting, running inside.
Yeah, they don't come out when it rains. It's not the night time or the daytime, it's the rain.
From The Ridiculous to the Sublime, Lee Davies, he's changed the tone on this one. A musical set in Blackburn where all the songs are Elvis songs. It's called Elvis Goes to Town. And this gets dark.
Okay.
It's about a mentally ill person, and all the musical numbers are like flights of fancy, and the protagonist is always dressed as a different version of Elvis each time. Film opens in a greasy spoon cafe. White jumpsuit Elvis singing A Little Less Conversation. He's climbing on tables and wrecking stuff. Song finishes and the camera cuts to our main character eating a depressing egg sandwich. The plot is similar to I, Daniel Blake, and the main character gets fucked over by the system and they end up killing themselves. The last song is Love Me Tender.
Jesus.
Bloody hell.
I think having some kind of Elvis musical where you could make something out of Elvis songs, attention to someone's head, or the viewing, you know, they're seeing things Elvis songs sounds like it could work.
That yeah. Elvis film should be directed by Shane Meadows, shouldn't it?
Yeah, it's a Shane Meadows film all over.
That's fucking weird.
Yeah.
What's wrong with that guy?
Yeah. Yeah, but you're going to like this one, Oodles, because Jonathan Firth Clark has written in saying, so I have an idea. I've had an idea for a few years now for a Metroid film pitch.
Oh, go on.
I don't have an idea for cast or a director, but I did have an idea for a story, or at least the outline of a story. This was, of course, pre-Metroid Dread, and it follows on from the American translation of Fusion, where it says Samus was on the run.
Yep.
And he points out, yes, that's right. It's canon into the games.
No, that's fucking good.
So who says now? If he has no cast, who do we cast?
Samus. It's Charlie's
just let me finish. He's got the pitch, yeah? And then you can cast it.
Okay.
So my idea was all based on the marketing angle. So the film begins with Samus on the run from the Galactic Federation and getting captured. Eventually, the transport ship she's on gets attacked by space pirates, led yet again by Riley. Is that Riley? Ripley. Sorry.
Ripley.
Read that wrong. Ripley.
Ripley.
It's Metroid, okay? Somehow they always come back. And then the ship crashes, and she's all alone on another planet facing down a new Metroid threat. But this is where the marketing angle comes in. All the trailers, all the set photos, all the reports make it seem like the first 30 minutes is the whole film. You keep the second and third act a surprise from the public. This way you can have your big names in the trailer playing the Federation Marines who capture her, but the twist comes that after 25 to 30 minutes they die, and this turns into a classic Metroid-style story of with Samus on her own battling the elements, the space pirates, and yes, the Metroids. I was tossing in the idea of titling it Metroid Nemesis due to the big finale not being Samus versus a Metroid, but Samus versus Ripley.
Yeah.
So it's not a fully formed idea, but I think that if the marketing is done correctly, it could work incredibly well.
I like it, and it's definitely Charlize Theron as Samus.
No.
In my opinion. Who are you reckoning?
I'm just looking at age-wise and stuff and things. I have a choice between either Brie Larson or Rosa Salazar, who played Alita in Alita Battle Angel.
Yeah, I did like Alita Battle Angel.
I would say Brie Larson. She's got the stature for it.
Mm. Yeah, she has.
Yeah, I think that'll work.
Yeah. Ooh, and obviously it'd be Chris Pratt as Ripley.
Because Chris Pratt's in everything.
Obviously.
I'm surprised actually no one made that joke in any of our pictures. Played by Chris Pratt. Chris Pratt
plays Sagat.
Chris Pratt as M. Bison. It's me, M. Bison.
Yeah. I'm not an racist. I'm not a promise. Oh, God.
Kurt Lewin has come in with strap yourselves in for what I think is an incredible film idea. First up, I need to say that I have Edgar Wright on board to write and direct this film, as I'm very much going for the British comedy vibe of the Cornetto trilogy.
Nice.
So basically, my idea is a spoof on Fast and Furious, but set in Britain, with the banger boy racer cars you see driving around supermarket car parks at midnight. We're talking old Ford Fiestas, Renault Clios, and Vauxhall Corsas. The thing is, though, that the budget is just as big as a Fast and Furious film, so you have the huge set pieces and ridiculousness, but with more comedy from Edgar Wright. I don't know what the plot will be, but I'll leave that to Edgar Wright. And he didn't mention it in the email, but he did say the title you would have as the film would be Bangers and Crash.
Oh my God! Yes,
I can see. It's like they're all bombing down motorway, and then they get to M25, and they're just stood still. And that's a good comedy move, isn't it? But I knew it were going to be Cars because it's Kurt. But I'm surprised he didn't think of James Bond. Another James Bond film.
That could actually work, really, like a UK version of
Well,
I mean, it worked for Hot Fuzz.
Fast and Furious, yeah. Like
Parked and Pissed Off.
But yeah, like kind of a comedy centered around like boy races and stuff. Think that they're...
It just could be called Penalty Charge Notice, couldn't it?
Fast and Furious, but no, they're not.
Have a nice set piece of them like launching their courser off a ramp or something to smash into a speed camera so that they don't get a ticket.
Yeah. And they're all meeting up in Tesco car park and stood outside having a meal deal, and then a Cornetto turns up.
Yeah. Perfect. I love it.
Massive Greg's heist.
Them yum yums. God, British culture is terrible.
And last up we have Ray. He's saying, I have an idea not for just one movie, but a whole franchise. The idea might sound silly, but I guarantee it's 100% doable and with proofs found on IMDb. It will be a Jaws film, but with a science fiction twist. Uh-oh. A group of college students attending a swimsuit vacation on a remote island find they're being attacked by a mutated two-headed shark, hence the film title, Two-Headed Shark Attack. The movie will be packed with action, adventure, thrills with a dash of unintended comedy on top. Furthermore, the cast and the production team boldly consists of new breakout actors, screenwriters, and directors, meaning you've never heard of them, breathing fresh air into the shark films for the 21st century. With the well-expected success of the first movie, sequels need to be made. This time, a mutated three-headed shark happened to some boat trippers, and then a starfish-like five-headed shark attack is reported, terrorizing the coast of Puerto Rico, followed by another six-headed shark attack at another island. We skipped four-headed shark attack because reasons. All in all, this potential of the series is sound limitless. We may even be about to witness another film universe big bang into existence.
I like it.
Ray, we love you. We love you so much, Ray.
I like it.
I'd have called it lots of jaws.
Lots of jaws. Lots of jaws.
Yeah.
Chump.
Chump.
I do like how...
Fucking nuts.
Out of all of us, including the listeners, including us, Gadgets was the only serious one.
Excuse me.
You can tell who the real writer is in there, out of everyone.
Hey, I'll have you know.
Yeah, mine was the historical only... piece set with by Tarantino, like full of people like Samuel Jackson, like going around.
But
saying,
the only original one, Gadgets just done that game I played.
Mine was the only original idea.
G.I. Jane, it's been done before. It's called Pride and Prejudice with Zombies.
No, bollocks. Not robots. Not mess.
Yeah, that was zombies. This is robots.
I knew completely I should different. Have my first choice.
I've definitely watched The Mummy 4.
What was your first choice, Bigger?
Are you going to talk about it in the green room? Save it.
I can do.
Okay, yes. Cool. We'll talk about other choices in the green room.
Oh, yeah, had left the mailbag this week. Now. Fuck.
Yeah, I'll tell you how I came up with the pitch of Bastard 66 in the green room. So, yeah, let's move on to the socials and what we'll be doing next week.
Right, socials then. You can visit our website, modernescapism.co.uk. On there you can find a link to all of our socials, contact details on our merch store. If you have any comments or feedback, you can fill out a form on our website, tweet us or email us on modernescapismpod@gmail.com. We've got a Discord server if you'd like to join our community of listeners for a chat about the podcast and many other aspects of pop culture and escapism. Absolute filth this morning. I cannot believe what I woke up to, what I was reading. Honest to God.
That was amazing.
Super
Natty Cat as well, causing trouble.
Oh,
or rather,
does she's
been
ever?
The victim of trouble this time.
Wow. I just feel like she was the instigator in this case.
It's harmony.
I've got some catching up to you.
Don't.
That was the most sinister thing you've ever said.
I know, right?
I've got some catching up to do.
Twitch.tv/modernescapism. You can find all of our playthroughs. The best place to find out of our schedule, or if we decide to do like a surprise stream, is to keep an eye on Twitter or Discord. We upload all of our playthroughs and all of our podcasts onto YouTube. So if you'd like to see us rather than just listen to us, you can find us on youtube.com/modernescapism. We've spoken about the Patreon. So if you'd like to throw us a bit of money so that we can carry on bringing you extra content and for a whole load of extra like bonus content for yourself, you can find us on patreon.com/modernescapism. And if you want to support us in a non-financial way, please leave us a 5-star review wherever you can. And it's always appreciated. Next week, we are doing One Season Wonders. So that's TV series where we've just had the one season and it's a bit another one and done.
That will be an episode. Thank you very much for that. And I think that's it for this episode for you non-paying listeners. So thank you very much and good night.
Bye.
Bye.